Hi guys, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. Thank you for once again joining me. If you are new to my channel, make sure that you subscribe so you can get notified every single time I upload a new video. Okay, let's get into the video. So today I wanted to talk about something that is constantly up for contention amongst feminists and amongst just the general public as a whole, especially in our country and within the African context. And it's the battle between culture versus feminism, and whether the two can ever interlink or work together to somehow create a harmonious society that everyone can live in peacefully. And it's something that I've always battled with, I've always contended against, I've always challenged and questioned why certain things are done in certain cultures, and why, you know, men and women are given separate treatments when it comes to certain rituals or certain ceremonies. And I've always had to sort of debate with myself and ask myself, am I letting go of my culture, or am I losing my African roots by wanting to become a feminist and wanting to advocate for the advancement of women in society? Because after all, culture shapes us and it makes us who you are today. Subconscious, whether you like it or not, you're growing up socialized to think in a certain way, and your culture plays a prominent role in that. So I think I once wrote an article about this, just expressing how I felt about certain cultural practices and how they actually affect women. Because in as much as I'm, you know, very Afrocentric and I believe in integrating African elements into everything we do, there's certain traditions and customs that I've really realized that are subliminally perpetuating a culture of patriarchy and are incubators of patriarchy. I know a lot of people might have different views, but it's okay, don't judge me. These are the things that I think are one of the cultural elements that incubate patriarchy. And I think first and foremost, especially within the Zulu clan, lobola, that's been my biggest debate ever since I adopted the feminist philosophy in my life. I've had to ask myself, would I want to go through that process and have umndeni wami, you know, execute the lobola negotiations? And I had to ask myself, what does lobola represent with on a fundamental level? What does it represent? What does it purport? And what is its intention? You know, and I've heard a lot of people talk about how lobola was initiated back in the day as a sign of respect for the bride's family, and it's all about exchanging gifts and, you know, wanting to build ubudlelwane, as they say it in isiZulu, with your in-laws. And I mean, it's all good and well, but if we think about it, back emandulo, when people were still using cows as the dowry instead of money that we see today, back then that was given obviously to the bride's family, so that the bride's family can be compensated for the loss of a female in the household who does most of the domestic chores and keeps the household running, right? So that was that sort of compensation, and as well making sure that we once again build a relationship with our in-laws. That was pretty much it. But from, okay, as an accounting student, I looked at this from a transactional and financial level. You know, I feel like ilobola for me equates to someone being able to exchange something of value to gain something of value. That is an economic transaction. That is, whether it's exchanging goods or exchanging money, that is the economic substance of that transaction. And I don't get the mere fact that somehow for me to get married, I have to have that exchange happen. It makes me feel like an asset. It makes me feel like something less than a human being. Because firstly, how do you even value that woman that you want to marry? What are the inputs that are computed to get that fair value? I'm speaking accounting language, I'm so sorry. But what are the inputs that are used to arrive at that number of 100,000 or whatever it is that people use these days to value women. You know, it's something that I really battle with, because the same thing isn't done for men, and you find that the man you marry actually has, I mean, less qualifications than you, or, you know, isn't as deemed as the woman is. So how exactly is that number arrived at? And for me, that's been my contention with the concept of ilobola, you know, making sure that you somehow exchange something of value to gain something of value. Marriage should be based on your humanness and your compatibility with that person and your love for them. The one thing that I love about the African culture, and especially in the Zulu culture, is the fact that when a man and a woman get married, apart from ilobola, we have other ceremonies like umabo and umembeso, where the families exchange gifts, and it's a jubilant celebration, and it's beautiful, filled with color, songs, vibrancy, and those are events that I look forward to if anyone in my family ever gets married. So if I had to talk about preserving elements of our culture, I think umabo and umembeso are things that I would love to preserve, because those are, you know, some beautiful ceremonies that I think should be kept in our culture. But definitely the concept of ilobola is something that I really battle with. It's something that I am really discomforted by. And I think as a society, we should look back and ask ourselves, what is the substance of what we are doing? Why are we doing this? Don't look at the form of it and look at, oh, you know, we do this because it's been done for ages and ages and ages. But at the fundamental level of it, what message is it purporting, and what concept of womanhood is it trying to portray? I mean, I even have an issue with the fact that during the lobola negotiations, predominantly the people that get to sit there and determine the price of a woman are men. And you'd find that in most households, women are there raising kids and making sure that the women grow up to be the best versions of themselves and the best people they can be. Yet when it's time to talk about the most important phase of their lives, which is marriage, they aren't allowed to be there simply because they're a woman. Although there are matriarchs and matriarchal households where some women are present at the lobola negotiations, people like your aunts or older cousins who are female, who've been there, who've helped you grow up, who've helped you navigate this thing called life, deserve to actually take a seat at the table and talk about how much they want to price their bride. So a lot of the things around ilobola are up for contention, and as much as we can sit back and say, no, it's part of our culture and we've done this for ages and ages and ages, that's great, but is it really conducive for an equal society that we want to build? I don't know. It's just something that I've always thought about, and it's something that I obviously internally battle with, because I mean, if ever I do get married, I don't know how that's gonna happen. But if ever it does happen for me, I really will sit back and ask myself, do I really wanna go through ilobol? I mean, I'll have umembes, I'll have umabo, but the very essence of lobola is something that is really going to eat at me, because I'm gonna have to ask myself, how are my uncles gonna arrive at my price? Like, how do you price a person, you know? But apart from ilobola and looking at it from an African context, I think in other parts of the world, especially in the Middle Eastern countries and Northern Africa, where Islam is the predominant religion, I've watched a lot of videos on YouTube and documentaries covered by broadcasters like CNN in those countries and continents, looking at how culture and religion affects the treatment of women, and how in those places it's still okay for children as young as 10 and 8 get married and get sold off to older men, and their parents are literally documented saying they did it because it's part of our culture or it's part of our practice. And I then sit and ask myself, at what point do we try to balance culture and say that culture has this threshold of an impact on our daily lives? Because at the substance and fundamental level of it, making a 10-year-old child get married to a man who is 60 is ethically wrong. It's morally wrong. The child has school to go to, the child has a life to live, and for culture to dictate what that child has to do. For me, it's something that's incredibly absurd, and it's probably one of the biggest injustices that we need to, as a global community, fight off. And then there are cases where people misquote culture to do what they want to do and to perpetuate their own agendas and intentions, and they end up completely distorting the message and the image and the concept of a certain culture, which again in itself I think is a huge injustice. People make young girls undergo genital mutilation and say it's our culture. People will try and do so many things and just slapdash culture onto it because that's the best excuse they can use. And I think we need to sit back and actually really ask ourselves if is this culture that we're really protecting our women? That's the first question. Is the culture that we're protecting our women? And if you look at it from the broader aspects of things, not really. But it is up for contention, and many people have their opinions about it, and everyone's obviously entitled to their own opinions. But I think this is just a call and a reminder to always look back at what you do before you do it and ask yourself, why am I doing this? Is it for the benefit of mankind and for women especially, because of the current climate that we live in? And does it aid in advancing the mandate that we have as a society to create a just and equal world around us? If not, then I'd rather not have my culture, unfortunately. But anyways, thank you guys so much for joining me on this video. If you do have alternate views, you can comment down below. Like this video if you liked it. If you disagree with me, you might as well just dislike it right now. It's okay. But I'll see you guys next time, and I hope you have a lovely week ahead.